Welcome. In linear programming, sensitivity analysis is a post-optimality analysis, also known as what-if analysis, conducted after obtaining an optimal solution. It determines how changes within specified ranges affect the optimal solution. We'll be answering questions based on this Excel solver sensitivity report of this LP model, where decision variables X1, X2, X3 represent the number of units of products 1, 2, and 3 to produce. The objective function represents total profit, and the model is subject to these constraints. The variable sales table deals with optimality ranges, that is, ranges over which the objective function coefficients could vary without changing the decision variable values in the current optimal solution. The constraint table deals with feasibility ranges, that is, the right-hand side ranges over which the dual or shadow price is applicable. We will be answering these questions based on the sensitivity report. Let's begin by determining the missing values A to E in the sensitivity report. Final value column here represents the decision variable values at optimal solution. For A, the value of X3 at optimal solution will be 0 because we have a non-zero reduced cost, -8.5 here. Whenever there is a reduced cost that is not 0, it means that the value of the decision variable is 0 at optimal solution. In essence, the cost of producing X3 should be reduced by 8.5 in order to produce X3. Since this is a maximization problem, it means that the profit on X3 needs to improve by at least 8.5 to make X3 profitable for production. The same logic applies for B. Since we already have a positive value for X1 here, the reduced cost will be 0. This is because X1 is already being produced, so we don't need to justify its production by producing a unit of it. In essence, if a final value is positive, its corresponding reduced cost will be 0. We will revisit reduced cost again in question 12. For C here, we require the right-hand side of material A constraint, which is given to us in the LP model as 90. Alternatively, we see that we have a non-zero shadow price here. This indicates that the constraint is binding, that is, the left-hand side equals the right-hand side at optimal solution. Similarly, for process A here, since the shadow price is non-zero, it is binding. Therefore, the missing value here will equal to the right-hand side value of 120. D here represents the shadow price for the material B constraint. This constraint is not binding because the left side is less than the right side. Constraints that are not binding on the objective will have a shadow price of 0. In this situation, we say there is a slack, meaning the right side of the constraint is underutilized. The slack amount is 80 minus 54, which gives 26. For E, we need the left side of process B constraint, which requires plugging in the optimal values of the decision variables, and that gives 33. Since the left side is greater than the right side by 3, we say we have a surplus amount of 3 units. Note that it is not sufficient to say the constraint is non-binding simply because its shadow price is shown to be 0. It is possible under some circumstances for shadow price to display 0 here for a binding constraint. We can correctly state that a constraint is non-binding if its left and right sides are different, or if it has a non-zero slack or surplus. Next, in question 2, we want to determine the total profit, which is the objective function value z at optimal solution. The objective function coefficients are found in the output here. Substituting x1, x2, x3 at optimal solution results in an objective function value or total profit of 1215. For question 3, the amount of product 2 that should be produced is found under final value here to be 12 units. This means that at optimal solution, the model recommends producing 12 units of product 2 to maximize profit. Since the reduced cost for x2 is 0, it indicates that product 2 is being produced at its most efficient level, given the current constraints. Question 4. How much of material B is unused? The amount of material B used is the final value of 54 here, out of the available 80 units. The amount unused is therefore 80 minus 54, which gives 26. This unused amount is called slack, which is associated with less than or equal to constraints, like the material B constraint. Note that this constraint is non-binding because the amount used is different from the amount available. Question 5. By how long is the minimum time for process B exceeded? This question requires us to determine the surplus amount for process B constraint, which is the final value or amount used minus the constraint right-hand side. For process B, the surplus is 33 minus 30, which gives 3. This surplus of 3 units indicates that the actual time used for process B exceeds the minimum required time by 3 units. In other words, the process is using 3 minutes more than the minimum specified in the constraint. Question 6. What will happen if total profit from product 1 increases to 40? Product 1 is associated with decision variable X1 with a current profit contribution of 35, which we want to increase to 40, an actual increase of 5. Our first step is to check the allowable increase to determine if that increase is allowable. Since the allowable increase is 18.33, then an increase of 5 is allowed. This implies that the optimal solution will not change with an actual increase of 5. The total profit, however, will change since we've changed one of the profits from 35 to 40. Our new profit can thus be found by increasing the old optimal profit by 5 times 21 or by recalculating the objective function at optimal point with a new X1 profit of 40. Either way, we obtain the new total profit of 1320, an increase of 105 from the original optimal profit. Question 7. What will happen to total profit if the amount of material A increases by 20? From the output, the allowable increase for material A is 70. Therefore, an actual increase of 20 is allowed. This implies that the shadow price of 5.5 applies for every unit of the 20-unit increase. The amount of change in the objective function is calculated as shadow price times change in the constraint right-hand side. Since both shadow price and right-hand side change are positive, total profit will increase by 5.5 times 20, which gives 110. That is, total profit will increase from 1215 to 1325. Question 8. What will happen to total profit if process A time decreases to 100 minutes? The current available time for process A is 120 minutes. Decreasing it to 100 minutes implies an actual decrease of 20 minutes. The allowable decrease is, however, 15. Since the actual decrease of 20 exceeds the allowable decrease, the shadow price no longer applies, and we cannot determine the impact of the change with this output. The problem needs to be resolved to reflect the changes. Question 9. What will happen to the profit if minimum process B time is reduced by 15 minutes? For process B, allowable decrease is given here as 1E plus 30, which effectively represents infinity. In essence, no amount of decrease in the constraint right-hand side will change its shadow price, which is currently 0. An actual decrease of 15 will therefore have no effect on the objective function. Normally, we will calculate the change in profit as shadow price 0 times the amount of change negative 15, resulting in 0. Therefore, reducing the minimum process B time by 15 minutes will have no impact on total profit. Next to question 10. You're offered 10 additional minutes of process A time for a total of $50. Should you take the offer? The allowable increase for process A is 43.33, so an increase of 10 minutes is within this range. The shadow price for process A is 6. The potential profit increase is calculated as shadow price times additional time, which gives 60. Since the potential profit increase of 60 exceeds the cost of the offer of 50, accepting the offer will result in a net gain of 10, which makes the offer financially beneficial. Now, question 11. To determine how much to charge for giving up 20 units of material A, we need to consider the impact on profit. Giving away 20 units of material A means decreasing it by 20 units. For material A, the allowable decrease is 30, which is greater than the actual decrease of 20, so shadow price of 5.5 applies. Change in profit will thus be 5.5 times negative 20, a $110 decrease in profit. Therefore, the charge should be at least $110 for giving away 20 units of material A. In question 12, we interpret the reduced cost for X3 and determine how it is calculated. The reduced cost of negative 8.5 for X3 means the profit contribution of X3 needs to increase by at least 8.5 for it to be profitable to produce. Or if we force the production of one unit of X3, the overall profit will decrease by 8.5. To determine how we can calculate this reduced cost, let's revisit the LP model. Observe that to produce one unit of X3, we require 5 units of material A, 3 units of material B, 4 units of process A, and 2 units of process B. In essence, this represents the amount by which the right-hand side or resources will decrease if we produce a unit of X3. Now, based on the shadow prices, an additional unit of product A adds 5.5 to profit, of material B adds 0, of process A adds 6, and an additional unit of process B adds 0. Therefore, by introducing one unit of X3, it will cost us 5 times 5.5 units of material A, 3 times 0 units of material B, 4 times 6 units of process A, and 2 times 0 units of process B, adding up to a total cost of 51.5. Now, the unit profit contribution of X3 in the objective function is 43, while the cost is 51.5. Therefore, the amount of reduction in cost required is 43 minus 51.5, resulting in negative 8.5, which is the reduced cost in the output. This negative value indicates that producing X3 is currently unprofitable, and its profit contribution needs to increase by 8.5 per unit to become viable for production. Finally, in question 13, we are evaluating the feasibility of introducing product 4. It requires 3 units of material A, 4 units of material B, 2 units of process A, and 0 units of process B. It is projected to generate a profit of $35 per unit. Should we introduce product 4? To determine that, we need to compare the opportunity cost of the resources it will consume from current products to the profit it will generate. The shadow price of material A is 5.5. Therefore, the 3 units of material A consumed will reduce profit by 3 times 5.5. Similarly, for material B, the reduction in profit is 4 times 0. For process A, it is 2 times 6. And for process B, it is 0 times 0. This results in a total reduction in profit of 28.5 per unit of product 4. Since product 4 is projected to generate a profit of $35 per unit, which is greater than the reduction in profit of 28.5, it can be introduced as it increases total profit by 6.5 per unit. And that's it. We examine the implications of changes in profit contributions, resource availability, and constraints on the overall profitability of the model. Thanks for watching.